Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you can all hear me. My name is John O'Sullivan. I'm the president of the Danube Institute. We are one of the organizations which has brought this event to you here today. The other, and we're grateful to all of them, is the Corvinus University and Pika Akosh-Bard, who is professor of economics here, and of course, distinguished figure in Hungarian distinguished figure in Hungarian public life, having been, among other things, the governor of the Hungarian Central Bank, will moderate the first and the third panels. But for the moment, let me just say a few things about this event before I hand over to him, and point out that we're grateful, obviously, to the university and to the economics department for their help and cooperation and involvement. Secondly, there are a number of organizations you will see on the list here. The principal one, I think, is the Austrian Economic Center in Vienna. And again, we're very grateful for their involvement and for bringing along a number of guests from outside of Hungary. I don't count as that, I'm inside of Hungary. Guests from outside of Hungary to this event today. And the other events, the other organizations you will see listed here, and I'm happy to talk about any of them if you have any queries in private. Good. Now, you will see that the event is described as the world after Brexit and Trump. And I'll say a little bit about those two names, but I think there's a third name we want to mention as well. And that is, we have to acknowledge that when we first discussed this event, we did discuss the idea of calling it What's Wrong with Capitalism. Not quite the same thing as What's Wrong with the Free Market, but a heavy overlap. Why did we consider that? Well, it's a catchy kind of a title, and you want to also attract the attention of rebellious young people, particularly young rebellious people, though my experience, there are quite a lot of old rebels in this world as well. And capitalism or the free market are not very popular in Hungary today. I would say that of all the countries of Europe, this is probably the one in which free markets are least popular, partly because they always or generally have the opposition of the left. Those parties on the liberal left center, which were favorable towards the idea, have lost a lot of influence. I won't say as a result, but certainly have lost a lot of influence, and consequently they're not around arguing for the free market as they were more passionately a few years ago. And thirdly, the existing government, though broadly speaking seen as a conservative government, is certainly not seen as a particularly free market, liberal or individualistic one. And so in a sense the free market has fewer champions in Hungary than it almost has anywhere else, which is unusual, because if I go back to my youth, the free market had very few friends in any country, but it has many more friends now as a result of the end of communism, the development of globalization, and the enormous rise into the world labor market of billions of Chinese and other Asian workers who were really outside of history and outside of economics until the end of the 1970s. So Hungary is here an outlier. It's an unusual state of affairs. And one of the reasons for that, before we get to the world after Brexit and Trump, is of course the financial crash of 2008. I think that had a very severe impact on conservative and classical liberal politicians across the advanced world. In Europe more than America perhaps, but in Central Europe and in Hungary more than most places. It had a very big impact in other ways. It reduced the morale and self-confidence of ruling elites in the West, which after 1989 had been extremely buoyant. And maybe the leaders of the countries in the West overestimated or exaggerated the success of the market, but certainly they minimized its importance and value after the financial crash for reasons which I am not persuaded by, but nonetheless did persuade many conservative politicians, as well as many politicians and economists and other intellectuals on the left. So that is, in a sense, the ground from which we start here today. The free market is, again, as it was in the in the West in the 60s and 70s, fighting uphill. The second two names there, Brexit and Trump, I will say this, that Brexit, we're going to find out today from our speakers what the economic and economic philosophy behind Brexit is, and what its impact is likely to have not only on Britain, but also on the countries of Europe. I therefore won't say a great deal about it. But there is a, I should acknowledge that I am a Brexiteer, but there is some dispute about the philosophical meaning of Brexit in economic terms. Some Brexiteers are extreme free marketeers and free traders. Others are thought to be more protectionist. I myself think that in Britain, at least, it's the free traders who are the dominant faction, and that any development of the negotiations over Brexit between Europe and Britain will in fact leave Britain as being very closely allied with Europe in terms of trade, perhaps opening to the rest of the world somewhat more energetically than it might otherwise have done. On Trump, well, I think Mr. Trump is what I'd call a work in progress. Almost every day one opens the newspapers, he's saying something slightly different, and sometimes very different, from what he'd said in the campaign. And that applies, I think, more to economic policy than almost to any other. I can write a review of a novel, but not of a moving picture while I'm actually in the cinema. So that's the challenge which is going to face our speakers now. So I just want to therefore to say, as far as we are concerned, this is an educational process. It's one for you and it's one for us. We expect argument and debate. The Danube Institute is conservative in culture, classical liberal in economics, Atlanticist in foreign policy, but we don't confine ourselves to speakers who share our views. We like to have a wide range of disputes among us. So that's my introduction. Now, let me turn over for the first session. I will reappear for the middle session to my colleague Peter Akos-Bard. My colleague in several instances, he writes for the Hungarian Review regularly. He's actually far too distinguished to be our economic correspondent, but he is in a kind of friendly way our economic correspondent. He has been a regular supporter of our events, and together he and the Danube Institute have created something called the Budapest Economic Club, which discusses economics once a month and advances just, in a sense, these meetings are for the purpose of mutual education and enjoyment, and we hope to advance the frontiers of knowledge in a modest way over dinner. So Peter, thank you for coming. You have a distinguished record at this university, of course. You've been a governor, as I've mentioned, of the National Bank. I can't think of anyone better to introduce this topic. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jeroen. The first sentence is welcome on behalf of one of the organizers, the Corvinus University. This is the building, and this is the room where we teach MBA students in English. I see some of my students, I see experts and journalists and alumni, and I think it's going to be a very, very interesting afternoon. Three panels, as you heard, on the wealth of nations and the health of nations, and we start with the health of nations. Now, the first panel will focus on Hungary. Health economics and the technology of health is, I think, country-specific. So we have two eminent Hungarian scholars, Petra, Baji, Ph.D., and László, Gulácsi, Ph.D., multiple Ph.D., both professors of our university. And before the coffee break, they will talk about the need, access, and quality of health services in Hungary. This is a topic, the health service, which is very much disputed all over the world, and Hungary is no exception. And so we ask the speakers to present their case. Now, I don't move here, and the reason is that we are recorded. So I asked these speakers not to move too much. You know, professors love to move and write on the table and make tricks to keep the audience alive. Now, you have to stay here for the ease of recording, and want to inform you that this is an open session recorded, voice and picture. And without further ado, I would ask you, perhaps Petra would start, and there will be a session for question and answers with mobile phones. And please introduce yourself for the records, because we'd like to, in some way, spread the knowledge after this event, which will end with wine and other practicalities. So don't leave if you don't have to go.
Okay, thank you very much. So welcome here at Corvinus University. I'm also an associate professor here at Corvinus University. Can you hear me, or shall I use the microphone? Okay, so the first session is about healthcare, and specifically the Hungarian healthcare. So I decided to start with some basic statistics and compare the case of Hungary with other OECD countries, just to be on the same page and to highlight the main challenges in the Hungarian healthcare system. So regarding the financing of the healthcare system, the healthcare expenditure is below the OECD average in Hungary, both in real terms and relative terms. So relative terms is a percent of the GDP. It's 7% in Hungary, while the OECD average is 9%. And in real terms, the difference is even more striking, that the financing in the OECD average is much it's like twice more, or more than twice more than the per capita expenditure in Hungary. Also, there is a big difference that even though we have a socialized health insurance model, the share of public expenditure is relatively low compared to other OECD countries. And 1/3 of the healthcare expenditure is coming from the pocket of healthcare consumers. We pay a lot of co-payment for pharmaceuticals, and the other type of payments we pay is fees for private healthcare services, and the third type, very interesting type, is informal payments in the public system, which I'm going to talk about. Regarding the healthcare services and the resources in the healthcare system, the number of physicians per 1,000 population is very comparable to other OECD countries, while we have kind of a shortage in nurses. You see that's below the OECD average. We have more hospital beds than in the OECD countries on average. It's decreasing everywhere in the world, but still we didn't reach the OECD average. And about technology, it's striking also that we are lagging behind quite a lot, because if you see the number of MRI units or CT scanners, that's much less than in other countries in the OECD. Well, at the same time, from the same or from lower resources, on the other hand, we do a lot of doctor consultations, because doctor consultations per year is twice as the OECD average, so it's around 12 per capita per year, which means that every Hungarian is visiting a doctor at least once a month, which is quite a large number. And also the average length of stay in hospital, for example, is longer than in OECD countries. So from the lower resources, the activity is higher, so it's also highlighting some challenges in the system. What I'm going to talk about now, after this overview of the main statistics, it's a special issue which, if you are not from this region, probably you are unfamiliar with, but I'm sure you will get very interested in this topic because it's a quite a unique one and creates a lot of discussions in the media and also among researchers. It's the case of informal payments, which is very a relevant issue in these Central and Eastern European countries. Just to be on the same page, to start with the definition, these are unofficial payments in the public system, which patients pay directly when they receive healthcare services. They pay directly to the physicians, and these payments are not registered. The patients don't get any invoice after paying this amount, and it's pocketed for the physician, so it contributes to his or her income without being official payment, without register being registered in the system. So there is a lot of discussion about these payments, and these payments can differ based on who initiates the payment. Is it the patient who just gives some payments to the doctor, or the doctor requires patients to pay? Who receives the payment? It's the physician, it's the nurses, it's the head of the hospital. So it also can be different in many countries. Who makes the payment? It's the patient itself, it's the family members, so it's also some issues, so it's a big burden for some households. What is the nature of the payment? This is the most interesting question. Is it, and I will talk about it a bit later, that what is the motivation behind this payment? And when is it made? It makes a lot of difference. It is made before the service is provided or after the service is provided. It also makes a lot of difference. And of course, in different countries, the legal situation of these payments can be also different. There are several explanations where these payments are coming from. Is it the heritage of the socialist regime, or it existed even before? Some authors argue that it's in these countries it existed before the socialist regime. The first explanation is the social cultural explanation, which says that these payments are more like a tip or a gratitude money, that we are grateful for the service and give it to the physician, and it doesn't change anything about the quality of the service. It's just an expression of gratitude. The other explanation, the legal ethical explanation of this payment, is that there is the reason for this payment is the shortage in the system, the lack of resources, the low salary of the physicians, and the need of patients to get better quality care or better access to healthcare services in the public system. This is also the economic explanation of the payment. The legal ethical explanation also adds that in the system there is no transparency and some administration issues are also the reason why these payments could occur. Well, for Hungary, the basic things about this payment that we studied in the recent years, that actually these payments are not so, doesn't represent a large part of the healthcare expenditure. According to our estimations, it's about 2% of the total healthcare expenditure. So we could say that, well, it's neglectable sometimes, but if we say from the micro see from the micro level that every second patient pay informal payments for hospitalization, we could say that yeah, it can be a big burden for households who pay, especially those who are more in need, so probably also in lower social economic status. And also from the micro level, it's a really relevant income for the physicians, the source of income for the physicians, because sometimes they double or triple their salaries from these payments. And the other thing which is coming from another research, and it's very important, that these payments are really unequally distributed among the physicians. So as you see that, let's say, according to the estimations, only 5% of the physicians get the 60% of the payments. So you can say that this creates some adverse incentives in the system. So those who are beneficiaries are certainly against any reforms in the healthcare system. So creates incentives. The legal status in Hungary is also kind of controversial, because the labor code in Hungary prohibits receiving informal payments, but the employer has the right to dispose the employees from this decree. So it's, I think it's a very Hungarian thing. At the same time, the ethic codex of the Hungarian Medical Chamber also mentions informal payments, and they say that that's an explanation of these payments is the is the low salary of the physicians and the dysfunctions in the healthcare system. And actually, they say that these payments exist, and this is the reason. So physicians are okay to accept such payments. Only if this payment is a gratitude and not asked before the service. So our department was a part of a large international study in this region, which involved six Central and Eastern European countries. This was coordinated by the Maastricht University. This was a five-year program sponsored by the European Commission. And this was the first study which allowed us to compare to make international comparison between the payments and the prevalence of the payments in different countries, because the literature existed even before our project, but for individual countries. And this was the first study where we collected data in the same time with the same question and same methodology. And these are the results. Probably the more interesting thing is the hospitalization with the red figure. And what we see is that I already mentioned that in Hungary, for example, every second patient pay informally in the hospital, and it's the same in Lithuania, Romania, Ukraine. Respondents in Poland reported a lower prevalence of informal payment. And Bulgaria also, but in Bulgaria there are formal fees as well for hospital stay. And we also studied, we made some estimations how much are these informal payments as a percentage of total health expenditure, and that I already mentioned that it's 2% in Hungary. It's more relevant probably in Romania and Ukraine, where it's about 6 or 7% of the total healthcare expenditure. We, in the same survey, we studied attitudes towards these payments, and Hungary is also like striking here, that population here is more tolerant. At least they report to be more tolerant towards these payments than in other countries. So more than half of the respondents were indifferent about these payments or had even positive attitudes toward these payments, while the majority of the respondents in other countries rejected these payments and had negative attitudes. And as I mentioned, that well, it's always interesting to study this question in a quantitative way, in a survey, where people report, yes, I think these are an expression of gratitude, these payments, but at the same time they say that, yes, these are the form of corruption at the same time, but they think it's both arguments are true at the same time. How they explain the existence of these payments is that they say that it's inevitable because of the low funding in the healthcare sector. So this was the most frequent reason for informal payment. And at the end, before we start the discussion about these issues, I also would like to show some results from a recent our recent study. It's a very interesting part. It's about maternity care. So we chose a specific sector to study informal payments further and more in depth, because of course studies report the prevalence of payments. They report who receives the payments. Sometimes they report what people say, what is the motivation of the payment. But what is missing from the literature and the question which we are also the most interested in is whether these payments affect the quality of care in Hungary. So meaning that those who are paying getting better quality of care than those who are not paying informal payments. And we chose the maternity care because this is the sector where informal payments are the most prevalent. And as you see from the graph from this international survey, in Hungary, Ukraine and Bulgaria, maybe not in Bulgaria, but Hungary and Ukraine certainly, like 70% of patients pay when they use maternity care in these countries. They pay to their physician. And that was a questionnaire survey carried out in 2014. Actually, the project leader was a Fulbright research fellow from the United States. And he was actually contacted us with this idea to merge these two aspects, because he's a gynecologist. He wanted to study satisfaction and with care and some disrespectful care indicators in the region, and he found out that it would be a very nice idea to combine this issue with informal payments. So this data collection also created a very nice environment for us, or opportunity for us, to study the link or association between the quality of care and these informal payments. So we had a representative sample of 600 women in the survey. It was an internet-based survey, so of course there are some limitations with the representativeness, but women with a child less than 5 years old were invited to this survey from all around Hungary. What we see that the main determinant of the payment was whether the women had a chosen provider or not. Chosen provider is meaning that there is a free choice of provider in the Hungarian healthcare system. So pregnant women can choose their doctor, their hospital, where they get receives the maternity care. But usually it's happening that the same physician who has a practice in the public hospital has a private office, and women are visiting this private office, but still the delivery takes place in the public hospital. And what we see that those women who choose a provider, they are much more likely to pay, so 80% of them paid informal payments. On the other hand, those who had no chosen provider just went to the local clinic, and the physician who was in duty, they just provided the service. In that case, only 20% of them paid for the delivery. And the main motivations why they paid after delivery was most of the respondents mentioned that they were thankful for the physician, for the care they received. But the major motivation was that they wanted a chosen doctor to be present at the birth. And of course we can choose our providers, but we cannot guarantee that that doctor will be present at birth. So it's a kind of implicit contract between the women and the providers that, okay, so I'm your chosen provider, you can call me anytime if you need something, if the delivery happens. They also mentioned access or better attention, but this was less frequent. What we found about the quality of care, and this is my last slide, you can see on your left is the intervention rates, and on the right is some disrespectful care indicators. So let's start with the intervention rates. What we see that the chosen provider model, there are much more interventions, so significantly higher intervention rates. So this is where women usually pay informal payments. I'm not sure how familiar are you with the maternity care and the standards and protocols in maternity care, but in general, high intervention rates are not so welcomed. Cesarean rates, for example, according to the recommendations, should be like 15% and not more, because then that's considered an unnecessary surgery. Induced birth also can lead to a cesarean section, which is not so nice. Epidural rates in Hungary are actually lower than in the other countries, other developed countries. But episiotomy rates are really high, very high, and this is also not according to the protocols and standards of the best practice of maternity care. So what we see that in the chosen doctor model, intervention rates are much higher. On the other hand, if we see the disrespectful indicators, whether women were poorly treated, had no consent for the care they got or the interventions they got, that they felt pressure or disrespectful care, or how they felt autonomy on their decision making, this is the MADAM score at the left side, we see that outcomes were better for the chosen provider group. So if you ask what we get for the informal payments, we could say that, well, on the one hand, we get higher intervention rates, which are probably not so necessary. But on the other hand, we get more respectful treatment. So this is then the choice of women, which model they choose. But it's a very good question whether they are aware of the best practice of the maternity care standards, or they just decide based on respectful care indicators. And this was these are some papers which we published recently in this topic, and some policy briefs and some PhD theses on the same topic, which I could recommend. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Petra. There will be a question and answer session, but my recommendation is that let's have this session after the second presentation, and please raise questions or comments after the two. We have to look at their work. But I cannot resist from making a note that Petra just zeroed in on a very, very hot topic in Hungary and very disputed story. That's not perhaps the most important issue of the healthcare, but a very much discussed and something which has a root in, as she said, in the culture, but also the economy of the healthcare, and sort of it's a footnote to what we are suffering from: a misallocation of resources, perhaps too much investment over financing of soccer. and sports stadiums and under financing of maternity wards. And thank you very much for your research. As far as I can see, there's also personal interest in the topic. Now, László, please take the floor, and then we'll have questions after the two interventions, please.
So, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being invited here today. And actually, my story will be completely different. So, but just one comment, last slide of Petra. This is what we call a supplier-induced demand in economics. Not much data out there, just lots of hypotheses, concepts, but very few data. So these are real data from 600 patients. Thanks very much. So my story is about... okay, and if I am speaking up, it's better. Yeah, because probably I need both of my hands. So, and I'd like to walk, but I know this is forbidden. So my story is different.
Not recommended.
Not recommended.
Nothing is forbidden.
So my story is about health economics. The concept of health economics, sometimes called health technology assessment or medical decision making, there are very different terminology all over the world. But the main aim of the methodology is to inform policymakers and financing bodies, the funders. This is the main aim. This is about needs and access. So my story is about how to measure a 1 year of life of a human, how to decide who should die and who should live, because these are the data which are really crucial for policymakers, at least in the more developed countries, but I hope we are in the right direction and we will end up somewhere there. The concept was born, actually the first institutionalized concept in the United States in 1967, I think, when the state healthcare system, Medicare and Medicaid, was established. Then the concept traveled to Australia, New Zealand, and back to Sweden, Canada, and finally every country in the European Union. And there is a specialized body in Europe financed by EC, European Commission, because you know this is about how taxpayer money is spent. So not because of the healthcare system, because the European Union does not have a mandate on healthcare in the neighbor, in the member countries, but has a mandate about how taxpayers' money is spent. So this is my outline. Actually, I have a much longer presentation than time, but you know, I don't want to go through everything. I try to identify your level of interest, and I try to pick up what I think the most interesting for you. But first, I have a story, because this is my story is my presentation about resource allocation, needs and access, and I'd like to show you what is behind. So just please read it, because I don't want to lose time just to read. I thought before that mainly audience from the United States are present. I recognized here that is not true, but probably this is relevant to all countries. So this is a question. Are you willing? I cannot move. Are you willing to take? Who is willing to take? Yeah? Because, you know, it's advertised, it's there, it's out there. This is in the guidelines of various internalists and the medical profession. This is financed by insurance or out-of-pocket payment. It's out there. I have a second question. What is the difference between the Russian roulette and taking aspirin? My question is how long you could survive, you know, the movie of a deer hunter, or the game of the Russian roulette. The answer is theoretically forever, but we do not suggest trying it. And what about taking daily aspirin, 75 milligrams, as 40 million Americans are taking, according to the FDA. This is a most prestigious body, Food and Drug Administration. They have good data. And you are willing to take as well, and probably many of you. So what is the relationship between the Russian roulette and the deer hunter and taking an aspirin? Could you please read, and I just pick up the most important. So this was the advertisement, this was the issue. This issue was presented by the American Food and Drug Administration, which practically shows, but tells, that if you haven't had a heart attack, please step away from taking 75 milligram aspirin, because, and this is at the backside, in such people, benefit has not have been established, but the risks are at present. So in this case, this is the relationship between the Russian roulette and taking an aspirin, that although for a decade, and this was a really a big business for pharmaceutical companies and a lot, large cost issue for the insurance companies, to cover 40 million Americans daily dosage of 70 milligram aspirin. But as the FDA issued, if you do this, you take risk, even you can die, but no benefit out of it. So this is my first message, and that is why this methodology was established in the 60s, because you know there is a rocketing healthcare budget. The cost side is, you know, it seems to be unmanageable. Even in the United States, you are close to the 15% of the healthcare from the GDP. And if the Obamacare is fully implemented, it's somewhere 20 or over. So no person, no human in this world who could any idea how to cover these expenses. One of the easiest thing is, and this is the message of this example, stop doing risky things without benefit. And here you can save 40 million times the cost of the daily dose of the aspirin. And this is not just a drug cost, because if you take the aspirin at least twice, you have to see the doctor, your blood have to be taken in laboratory, and then, you know, it's a huge cost issue. So this is the first step. So I wanted to make a good impression in the very beginning that what we are doing is something real, so you can have a, you can save your budget, and everybody is better off, and nobody worse off. But of course, this is a very ideal situation, so it's not frequent. So why is it required? And this is the policymakers and funders. They want to know in all over the world whether the drug has a clinical efficacy and the drug is safe. In my first example, the drug has no proved clinical efficacy, but proved harm. So the drug is not safe. So please don't spend on a lot of money on this, because you are, everybody's better off if he stops spending money on it. Cost effectiveness in all countries, it means cost effectiveness, how much are you able or willing to spend, I mean as a country or a state and an insurance, to save 1 year from the whole human life. So this is a cost effectiveness practically. I show you the concept a minute ago, because we are not just discussing about the human life, but quality adjusted human life, because we created, I mean, not me, but the founding fathers of the health economics, a new measure. And a measure is a good measure to measure the quality of life and the length of life. And this is just one figure. Why is it so? Because we would like to live long as possible, but only if our quality of life is acceptable. This is not just an economics issue, this is ethical. No one wants to live like in the last 15 years like a very serious case of dementia patient, at least not me. So this, but it depends on a lot of things, because we are different. We are different by ethnics, different culture, different religions. So we are not the same. So even Europe, in this point of view, is extremely heterogeneous. Or even North Germany is not the same as South. South Italy is not Milan, or Seville is not Barcelona. So they are different. So they, all these regions have different institutions dealing with this topic, because simply no generalizable message here, even in Spanish, in Spain, or in Germany, because you are too big, you are too different. And people, taxpayers, want services really tailor-made. So I don't want your service, I want mine, based on my expectation and my value. So what is the health gain? We have to calculate the health gain at society level. So this is in the different countries. I'm just simplifying the story because I don't want to bother you with a very detailed story. This is a cost-effectiveness threshold. The basic message is who should live and who should die. How much a quality-adjusted life years, which is practically a good quality life year, costs. And how much are you willing to pay, I mean, you are a funder, a society, to save one life, to save one quality-adjusted life year. So this is the issue. It's not very complicated. The methodology is complicated. And in a number of countries, they fixed a threshold, and the threshold shows how much, let's say, the Hungarian National Health Insurance Fund is permitted by law to spend to save 1 year of the human life. This is usually in different countries 2-3 GDP per capita. I'll show you here. You see the Hungarian GDP. As I mentioned, I thought we have Americans today, so that is why the American GDP. But you know the GDP per capita in your country, and at least you know that your GDP per capita in your country is closer to the Hungarian or closer to the United States level. So 2-3 GDP level in, say, Hungary, 24,000 US, and the US, they don't use the GDP per capita type of things. This is a general $100,000 per year in a state-funded healthcare system. No one has any idea what how a private health insurance business is being done, because this is something else. But you know, this is, has a less interest because private health insurance does not use taxpayers' money. So this is not really heavily regulated in this respect. Or in Germany, you have around 40,000-50,000 euros. So it seems to be a big amount, but this is not a big amount. Just imagine if somebody has a genetic disorder, or somebody has a need a biotechnology treatment, which could be 10 million even euros, or 100 million Hungarian forint per year. So this is not a very high amount. If we would take this just purely the health economics view, all chronic care disease and cancer and low weight births, we should leave them die. So this is not a not a high amount. I'm presenting now the health economics view, but of course the policymakers use this data. Plus, as I mentioned, we are living in a human society, we have culture, we have ethics, so many more things have to be taken into consideration in the financing decisions. But this is a must by law, that the decision makers has to know this figure, and they will see what to do with it. Okay. This is too complicated, and it's probably better to show how does it work. If somebody is interested, we just presented I think it's impossible to read there. In Central and Eastern European countries, this is a present stage of this methodology, the institutionalization and the transparency. In short, Poland is a forerunner. They are doing best. They have a big institution, big staff, budget, and a very high level of transparency, which means that if you, a taxpayer or a citizen in Poland, if you want to know how your taxed money is used and how healthcare resource allocation decisions are made, you're hardly likely to have a information. If you are in Hungary, if you are in Romania, or even in Slovakia or in Czech Republic, you have no chance. So although this is 8-10% from the GDP, you have no information about how resources are allocated, what kind of services are financed, and what are out of the financing reimbursement scheme, and why. So this is one transition question. If we are more behaving like more industrialized countries, is that we need more information to be provided to the citizens, because the citizens have to decide whether they like this kind of resource allocation decision making or not. The basic underlying cons. I stop here for just for a minute, because I spent 5 minutes just to introduce you the quality of life concept. This is the natural progression of the disease. If we have a drug, like a biological drug, this is an example of rheumatoid arthritis disorder, rheumatoid arthritis. You know, there is a disease progression going on, and then in a certain minute, a moment, the patient receives the it's supposed to go back as well, the eyes here. So probably you can push them back. So this is the disease progression. So patients are getting worse and worse and more serious. Just a small pain in the beginning, and then some years later, it's the patient is impossible to look after herself. The daily routine is impossible, cannot wash herself, himself, cannot go to the toilet. And if, let's say, biological treatment is given, which is very expensive, it's some million, could be some million, it is some million Hungarian for a year, it is very expensive even for the Norway's or for the UK, can push these disease back. How decisions are made? We measure the quality of life, which has two ingredients. One is the length of life and the quality of life. And then we compare this quality of life to the investment. I jump here because this is not very important. How to measure quality of life? This is a result of a professor from Britain, York, Alan Williams. He's a first questioner. It is an empirical study. If we know five dimensions, and if you know three options per dimensions, we can describe everybody's quality of life. So mobility, self-care, usual activities, pain, discomfort, anxiety, and depression, and you have no problem, mind problem, severe problem. May I use your example, if you don't mind? Because she was fallen, and probably she had some pain. So before you were fallen, your mobility was great, and some minutes after, I recognize your mobility, you had my problem. Am I right? Self-care, it's probably not affected. Usual activities is okay. You are sitting here and smiling. Thanks. Pain and discomfort, mild at least, yes. Anxiety and depression, I guess not much, at least as I see. So you have a one, you have a two, one, one, two, one. This is exactly what I told you now. So this is a one. Here is another example because, of course, I didn't know what happened. This is a hip fracture. This is like a barcode. Here, it's the easiest, but this is used. This is by law. You have to use it in all European Union countries because all resource allocation decisions have to be based on this. So this is a barcode. I know it's very difficult because we have not enough time, but I'd like to show you because I'm so happy. This is a very, very, very good methodology. So this is a barcode. Just imagine, somebody is a patient after a hip fracture, a ski accident, go to the hospital. You read my barcode or her barcode, and after the operation and after the rehabilitation and after everything, you have a higher level of health state. So not 11112 and 22122. For 11112 and you got 22122 after some days or weeks. You see, these are two different health states measured by this. Peter, is it understandable?
It is.
It is? Please don't be too kind. I should say stop. And because I'm here not to listen to something which is ununderstandable. And the right side, and I'm not really spending time on it, this is the utility of this given health state. For economists, it's nothing new. This utility can be measured by type reimbursement or any willingness to pay type of methodology. And this is really measured in based population samples in the UK, in Hungary, in every country, in Germany, everywhere. So we can describe different health states, and through research we know the utility of the different health states. So as you see, if you got the right treatment, you see before the fracture the health state was quite okay because this is a between 0 and 1. After the ski accident the health state was very bad. after that the rehabilitation and everything, you have a much better health state than after the accident. So the gain, the health gain, this is 0522 minus 0051. So we have a figure, and this is the health gain. So we know the health gain. And this way, probably you recognize, because you are a psychologist, that this is not diagnosis dependent. This is utility dependent. So we don't care about what kind of diagnosis, because the funding agencies don't care. They don't know. They are not physicians. They are economists. So here, this is a good visualization of the health gain. If we collect data about the costs, we can compare the gain and the cost, and we ended up with a cost effectiveness. So that's it. It seems to be very easy within 5 minutes, but it's a fantastic and it's very growing research all over the world, because as more and more new technologies are knocking the door of the funders' door and the state, they want to use this. So who should live, who should die? This is the question, this is the threshold question. Just an example, 10 years ago, lots of money was spent on cancer care, and then they recognized that the cost per quality-adjusted life year ratio was very unfortunate, very, very bad. So now they are reallocating from the cancer care to the maternity care, in the UK, for instance, or cardiovascular diseases, because in the societal level, the gain on the level using the same amount of money is higher. But this is just the health economics, but you know, you have to have a very well, a good sophisticated system, not a healthcare system, but a state, in order to use this better. This is a visualization. If somebody is in a full health, like Petra, he lives one quality adjusted life years within a year, okay? If somebody has a broken leg and everything after a ski accident, probably this particular person lives one quality adjusted life year within 2 years, you see? So in this way, we can visualize the health gain and the cost. So probably the treasury ministers will be less, probably the treasury minister will like more the healthcare system in the future, because in the past, they were not able to measure how the money is used and what is the effect and cost effectiveness of the money was spent in the healthcare system, okay? So here, this is rheumatoid arthritis. This is a disease progression as they are getting worse. And this is the relationship with the cost. The yellow is an indirect cost, direct non-medical cost. The blue is the direct cost. So you see, as the disease progression is going on, the costs are growing very rapidly. And if you can intervene and you have a good treatment, you can push the whole process back. You calculate the quality gain, quality of life gain, quality of just the life gain in societal level. If you are living in a country with a very high GDP per capita, you can afford more because your financing threshold is high. So that is why the needs and excess is always, it's not medically determined, but GDP determined, not the medical. It's a conclusion. If you don't know this figure, you have no chance to set up and manage a sustainable health policy and funding system. I show you just one more slide, two more. And so you see here in this slide, on the vertical axis, this is an FTX, this is a rituximab, it doesn't matter, this is a biotech, very expensive. This drug is a revolutionary drug for cancer and rheumatoid arthritis. And you see that how many patients are treated per 100,000 citizens in a given country. Okay, this is the vertical axis. And here, the horizontal is a GDP. So as you see, Denmark, Sweden, they have a Finland, they have a very high level of GDP, they spend more. In, let's say, Bulgaria, Czech Republic, Romania, Poland, Hungary, the GDP per capita is significantly lower than in Sweden so far. So we spend less. So you might conclude that richer countries spend more and countries which are more resource-constrained surrounding spend less. This is what I thought, and I stopped thinking this, believing this 2 years ago. And this is the last message. Because I thought, okay, if you have a bigger pocket, you can spend more. If you have a lower, smaller pocket, we can spend less. What should be researched here? Nothing. But here, as you see, these are countries in Central and Eastern European countries. Here is Slovakia, Hungary, Czech Republic, Poland, Bulgaria, and Romania. In the vertical axis, again, how many patients are treated, sorry, how many citizens are treated by really expensive biological drugs. This is, for example, this is rheumatoid arthritis. I hope you know more or less what is rheumatoid arthritis, United Church, yeah? And the vertical axis, again, the GDP per capita. So this makes life more interesting. The Polish GDP per capita is lower or higher than Hungarian?
Who knows? It just passed Hungary.
Yeah, it just passed Hungary. Excellent, thanks very much. But in Hungary, as you see, if you are a citizen in Hungary, and if you are eligible for a very expensive biological treatment in Hungary, and you are suffering in rheumatoid arthritis, I hope not, this is just an example, you have more than 10 times higher chance to get this treatment than in Poland. Although the regulations are the same, we checked. Health economics guidelines are same. This is a harmonized part of the European regulation. So everything is the same. The drug price is the same, you know, it's a reference price, it's reference countries, you cannot sell products in Europe anymore and really cheaper or more or expensive because the price is practically the same. We checked. What we haven't checked yet, because haven't conducted research here, is our hypothesis. Our hypothesis is that probably the health state, because of the rheumatoid arthritis, the importance is valued lower in Poland than in Hungary. This is just an hypothesis. If you don't agree, I cannot convince you because we haven't finished the research yet. So even the basic concepts doesn't work. So if you have more money, you spend more in general, yes. If you have less money, you spend less in general, yes. But even in the same GDP level, still huge differences. In the Central and Eastern European countries, the highest and lowest chance, all these countries are European member states, 96. Compared to Bulgaria to Hungary. So this is access, this is need, this is who should live, blah, blah, blah. Peter, thanks very much.